10% of the questions on the STAR test was DOK-2, and the other 18% was DOK-1. So are the majority of the way that our kids are going to be tested is through 2, but there are some DOK-3s on the test as well. So what is DOK-3? What's the difference between 1, 2, and 3? I wrote up here, if you are posing questions to your students, what you should say in your head when you're posing a DOK-3 level question, can the student explain, generalize, or connect ideas from one text to another? That's a DOK-3. So it's not just basic recall. DOK-1 is recall and reproducing. DOK-2 is skill and concept. DOK-3 is critical thinking. So this is where most of our pre-AP classes should be, and it's also a good idea at the end of the unit to pose this to our regular ed students as well. So, you can switch the slide. This level requires students to contrast or compare people, places, events, and concepts, convert information from one form to another, classify, sort items into meaningful categories. So it's about the verb and what you're actually doing with the concept. So I am posing you a level 3 question right here. You're going to work on this independently on the paper. Well, y'all, I wasn't planning on you crumpling your paper from the last one. So there should still be enough paper on the desk for you. So if each person could take a paper, if you don't have enough, then just tear it in half. I'm going to give you 2 minutes to explain, generalize, or connect ideas using supporting evidence to the role of the teacher related to the student in DOK-3. So I'm going to read that one more time. I want you to explain, generalize, and connect. So you're connecting the role of the student and the role of the teacher using supporting evidence. So looking at what the student's role is and what the teacher's role is, I want you to connect them. And I want you to use supporting evidence that allows you to do that. So I'm actually going to give you 4 minutes because it's a tougher question. It's not a basic question. Well, you're all looking at me like I'm crazy right now. Thank you. point out about a DOK-3 question. DOK is not, it's not synonymous with difficult. That's not the point of depth of knowledge. It's not difficulty. It's about how much thinking the child is required to do. That's what the levels are about. And the DOK-3 has higher cognitive demands. It usually requires evidentiary support. You have to explain and justify your thinking. And more importantly, most of all, there's generally more than one correct answer. So there's not one correct answer that the student's going to come to. So a lot of you are like, oh my God, I want to put the right thing, and you're racking your brains and you look like you're struggling, but there's not just one right answer to this. There's many correct answers. So when you're posing your questions, be thinking about that. So what I'm gonna ask you to do is stand up. This is another strategies for labeling.
Questioning to them in their life.
struggle, have those examples ready for them to go and look at ahead of time, and show them where to find the answer instead of just giving them the answer, which we've all done, I've done too.
So mine kind of piggybacks on that. I said the connection between the teacher's role and student's role in this is that it requires thought on the part of the teacher and the student. The teacher must think of ways to pose questions that cause students to think and answer in the higher level ways. Questions will need to be carefully constructed so that they cause students to have to think and apply knowledge in order to answer the question. And then students explaining their thinking process is a way to do this.
But,
like, you have to plan, like she, like Ms. Camp was saying, you have to plan ahead of time to figure out, to make sure your questions that you're asking are causing. Because it drives me crazy as an English teacher, sorry, reading teacher, when they give a kid a question that says, make an inference. Make an inference about the, no, you need to ask the question that causes them to make an inference. You don't just look at a kid and go, make an inference. That's totally, it doesn't work that way.
Too vague.
Yes.
Yeah.
In science, we have this, what they call a CER, the claim, evidence, and reasoning. So when we pose a question and we look at the claim, similar to a hypothesis, what is it that you question about this? And now you give the evidence. Evidence is what you've been taught. Okay, but the reasoning behind it is the scientific facts, the laws, the theories. So it ties it all together, and it's called the CER. And it requires them to know the foundation, like a cake, gotta have the foundation, the first layer. Then what are the fillings? What are the things that are in the middle? So I tell my kids, okay, you gotta have a cake. So what are the different layers? You've gotta have this. You can't frost the cake, you can't put the decorations on it unless you've got the foundation. So you've got layers of learning to do. And I think referring to that when you were saying that it wasn't the most difficult thing that we're supposed to do, I think we are just trying to find a way to go ahead and create those layers, because without the layers, it's not a complete thing, not a complete product.
So you would say like the in-between would be the relationships between them?
Yeah.
How they relate to each other, that's the biggest.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Because you have to know each part of it in order to say how
right.
They have a common.
And I was just thinking, is it possible for us to share like different strategies like that, because her mentioning the CER would be awesome to use in social
mm-hmm.
studies, because I think sometimes we try, like she said, we take pieces of it, we try to do the C, and then we try to do the E, and then the R, and it can get all over the place, but I think it's great if they see it in science, and then when it comes
see,
to social
yes.
studies, they see the same thing, and so we know we're all doing that, you know, level three.
I think that we would have a lot of buy-in if there's somebody that's doing it really well that's willing to come to PLC and say, this is an example. Like having teachers give the example themselves would be, I think, or videotape when we watch it, but I
yeah.
think, you know, we're not experts. You guys are experts in your field. So having your support and saying, no, that'd be really awesome if we could mimic that, absolutely.
You know what? The claims and evidence and reasoning, it's not just a science thing. It's for all content.
Right.
It's for language arts, for social studies, for math. It's not just for
yeah.
science. So, but I'm glad that you brought
that's
that up.
That's a good idea.
That's awesome.
But I think with, like, when we start talking about slavery and, you know, there's two different claims on why it's other than on like why it's different and why it's not. Like that would be perfect for you to have an
yes.
reasoning.
Yes, absolutely.
But I think like
yeah.
if that works for you guys as
mm-hmm.
taking it to level three, like, hey, let me share that with social
yes.
studies or, you know, English and stuff like that.
Very good. Was there anybody else that wanted to share out before you've gone? About what they
I one more thing. I think it helps to tell kids that there's not just one answer.
Right.
Like for them, they feel uncomfortable.
They want to be right.
Yeah.
And
they want to be right.
Approval,
and so, yeah, I think it helps their comfort level a little bit when you say, look, there's not just one right answer.
Right. And in math, there's not just one right way to get to the solution.
Right.
So that's another way that you can relate it. So complex graph, these are things you can do to facilitate this in your classroom. Set up a database, conduct investigation, video or podcast, analyze survey results, informational report. Analyze results of a questionnaire or survey, prepare an informational report about the area of study, prepare for and participate in a debate. So it's just basically getting the students to think on their own and be able to develop their own thoughts and ideas. and not only be able to develop their own thoughts and ideas, but be able to support it with edits. That's the most important part of it all. Possible questions? Does everybody have, where did you get that?
We passed the worksheet out to everyone.
You what? We have this, this is what I've been looking at, but also we made you the little yellow ones, if you don't mind holding that up. We've made you that too. These are just sentences. I think the biggest thing that you need to realize whenever you're creating these questions is depth of knowledge is the depth of thinking and the context to which the verb is being used. That's what decides what the level is. So it's not just the verb, so you really have to be careful just because it's on the chart. You're really thinking about what you're having the student do. Okay. The object in front of you was a level 2 and a level 3. So now we're asking you and your group to pose a level 1 and level 2. Now we're asking you and your group to pose a level 3 question about the object in front of you. Does anybody want to borrow the wheel? Now when you're done, you can go ahead and place it up here on the board.
One fell off.
Sounds like a pop out set. Oh, that's terrible. Right hand. My daughter and my niece are both lucky. It would help if I put a question mark. Yeah. Okay, I already got 2 cups today. That's like more than I normally have. What if I drink it all day? Right now?
Similar to that, right? Especially with the tasks that you
Thank you, sir.
The note that says
gonna go get us lunch, we're having a working lunch.
But his looks like that one's gonna allow them.
You want sevens?
They want a lot of the plane.
It's 10:30. We're good.
Hey, but remember we're having a working lunch.
What is that? Why at a 5, 6?
7.
7?
7.
It looks
what, did you drop it?
I don't know. I just noticed it the other day. I didn't get it. No, it's okay.
I hate my camera though. Every time I have cameras, it sucks. Everything's all grainy. It's all grainy. And the videos are crazy.
But on Saturday, luckily, it's supposed to be protected. Yeah. It looks like it's cracked.
Oh, is it the flip one?
Yeah,
we got locked.
Yeah. No, it's not a flip one.
And then my case doesn't.
It's just a protective case. Yeah. But it's like $40 for the cover.
I have it on my computer.
Yeah, but it's a good one. It's literally protected.
Okay, yeah. I was going to do this. I think it's the guy who gets opened up with one.
We're missing one table. We almost got it. Okay. Oh, we did.
Yeah. I was going to check a little bit. Sorry.
Dude, I'm still missing one table. At the north side, you guys have yours up here? ELAR?
It's coming.
Okay.
So can you project in your room? Okay, we're going to be in your room. Yeah, because the ELAR wants to be in the room. But when we're going to meet in there, we're not going to meet in there at the same time. It's just a game. So we can move the ladder. Yeah, I'm gonna fix that.
My phone doesn't explode?
No, on your. Because he's supposed to switch up my video game. My screen is blue again.
Got it.
It's
got
gonna totally go off. I put a ticket in a long time ago, so Julian's got
to go back today.
So I think that the point that I'd like to make for the amount of time it took for us to develop these questions is that it's going to take longer time during planning, which is why we're asking you to think of the questions when you're doing your lesson plans and actually placing your lesson plans. So you have the time to think about these questions that you need to ask. They're not just on the slide. You have to really think about what you're asking the students to do. Okay, so remember, we're doing the same strategy, thumb up or thumb down, agree or disagree. Can you formulate a theory for why a pyramid formula is 1/3 the base times the height?
I'm going
to say. Can you formulate a theory for why a pyramid formula is 1/3 the base times the height?
No.
No, okay. It's a level one because you said can you. That's a yes or no question. If you take off can and say formulate, you can.
It's not about the verb.
It's
about
the sentence that you give.
But
can
is a question of yes or no.
If you say formulate this and you leave all that, that's definitely a level three.
It's on the list as can you, so that's probably why they chose it.
Granny Pants will tell you different in training, I'll tell you that. The one that was given.
I think the biggest reason, the point of this is the justification.
Right. Yeah.
That they're justifying. That would be the point here. And that you might get different answers.
Are you talking about Dixie?
But you're right, it is.
Yes, I can.
I love Dixie.
Okay. I'm not sure. I don't know what I mean. That's what she said to
call. All right, the next one. Predict the outcome if you apply pressure
on a vertices
to one of the vertices and supply evidence to support your prediction.
It's going to crash.
can or predict the outcome if you apply pressure to one of the vertices and supply evidence to support your prediction.
Yes.
Yes, that's a level three. Because she's saying, what happens when you push on one of those corners and you have to justify it with the solution? So that's a good one. Okay, the next one. Can you formulate a theory for why the Egyptians...
Actually, ma'am, it just says formulate a theory.
Egyptians used this shape for their pharaohs...
Tombs.
That's good.
That's awesome, because you're not only doing... You're connecting cross-curricular. Okay, the last one. How would you change the object to create a new shape? How would you change the object to create a new shape? Okay, ELAR, I see some thumbs down. What do we think about this one?
Level two. We just think it sounds like level two.
Why?
It's not evaluating anything.
Okay, it's not evaluating, but there's one word that is lacking.
Predict.
How would you change the object to create a new shape?
Predict. It's supposed to be the one, the third one. How would you adapt the object to create a different shape?
How would you adapt the object to create a different shape? I don't really see any justification though. Because for this they could say I'd add another side.
Right.
It's not really explaining how the change would occur.
That's what we're saying is that during this training, there was a lot of things that we were like, okay, this seems like a two, but it could be a three because some of them overlap. It's the task. So if they're having to, how did they word it?
How would you change the object?
How would you change? They could just say add another line. Is that really a deeper, or they could add another side?
What's your reasoning?
But they
why?
Can't because it wouldn't create it.
Yeah, what's your...
So you have to expand a little bit.
You can expand. Yeah.
Right.
So this is
support
a good...
Support your theory.
Yeah.
But it is open-ended because there are several ways that can be answered. So
right.
It's like it's headed in the right direction. There's just a couple things you can tweak to make it a little bit better.
Yeah.
All
right. But you're on track.
That's DOK 3. Yeah.
Okay. Instead of a 15-minute break, because you already took your 7 plus 7 earlier, we are going to...
Can I have just a quick, guys, thing? This is the beginning of the training. So what I want you to know is that now we're going to go in and we're going to embed this into your planning, but we're also going to go full cycle because we're going to start asking you to bring student work to meetings and to talk about and to PLCs to look at the activities that you're giving our kids and what they're doing with those so we can say, is this a level one activity, is it a level two? Because I think a lot of us think that some of the things that we're doing are actually at a level two and three, and they're actually at a level one. So we're not only, they've been talking about tasks all day, and so what the task is truly that student work, right? So part of the process is, now you've been introduced, we're getting to know the DOKs, you're going to embed it into your planning, and you're going to plan for these level two and three activities, correct? We know that when you're first introducing something, it's level one, but we're making sure that we're getting to that level three. Now we're going to start analyzing the work and what we're doing, what we're giving the kids, the tasks that we're having them to do. You have to remember, guys, many of you love to teach, right? But that means you're up there. So we're looking at what are you having the kids? Your lesson may be great, but if you're the one doing all the work and doing all the things, you're the one relearning it. You already know it. So we have to think about, I'm going to facilitate, and I want you to start thinking in that way. I'm the facilitator. Maybe when you're introducing a concept, you're building and you're teaching and you're having them do that guided work and that check for understanding. But once we start to get it, I've taught it, now what are they going to do with it? That's the part that we don't seem to get to. Does that make sense? We get to the teaching and we get to the maybe the manipulating of the information,
But we don't actually hand over and say, now you've got to do this with this information. So that's where we need to go, and that's where we're going to be coming back and pulling the work that you're giving the students, and we're going to say, bring some more examples from this week so we can see what activities are you doing and are at what level are they at. Okay? To ensure we're all going to that next level and not just staying at the level one. So when you're, I like Mr. Haskins before he's left, he said it's the power zone of silence. Are you working on your power zone of silence? In other words, are you giving the kids enough time, and are you backing down and getting quiet and letting them do the work and letting them work through the problem, and you're facilitating by going around and answering questions, not to everybody, but to each group, and say, well, okay, what are our questions here? While the others are trying to figure it out. You're a facilitator.
And the kids are generating the questions, not us probing so much.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And the kids can generate the questions. I liked an activity I went into Ms. Green's, and she was having the kids write questions, and then you ask the kids what level they are? How can we go deeper, right? How can we make that into a better question and an open-ended question?
Add something to that, because I think there's a lot of thinking required, and that's what we want our kids to be doing. It's the task that we're choosing, but it's the thinking that's required of them within that task. And a lot of that, we have to look to our standards, right? Because we need to look at the context of each of our standards. We need to be standards based, and we need to think about the process standards. When we're designing our instruction around those process standards, and we're getting them to do things where they're showing ways to show, ways to know, you know. It's designing our instruction around those processes, standards, and making sure that they're thinking. That's what we want to get at, okay? So we really want to look at our standards and what they need to know, and then what tasks we're doing and what kind of thinking is required of them. That's really big.
So this is the full cycle. So we're lucky enough to have a person in each content area this year that is a content expert like you, and that you're going through the whole thing to figure out, okay, here we are, this is the standards. What are we, and how are we going to teach it? What activities are we going to do to get them to that level? And then come back and say, hey, how did that, looking at the data? Are you seeing the full cycle of the entire thing? Which we do, but we haven't done it as concrete as we're going to do it now. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
I was going to say, on my husband's campus, well, I guess it's like throughout North Carolina, they have like a 10 and 2 rule. For every 10 minutes that you teach, you have to give them 2 minutes process it, or to basically pose those higher level questions to again cause them to think in those higher level ways. Mm-hmm. But it's like he said, for every, because he was like 10 and 2, and I was like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
And he said, for every 10 minutes, we have to give them 2 to process and share.
And that's why we've kind of said every 5 to 10 minutes, you're checking for understanding. And guys, that's most of the time, that's not a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Mm-hmm. That's procedural, right? It's you've got to ask them questions so they can discuss it and talk about it. Those open-ended, write a sentence about it. It's not, I'm checking for understanding. Does everybody understand where we're at? Boom. Mm. Thumbs up. This is everybody on page 10? Yes, thumbs up. Show me that. That's a procedural, right? Okay. But I want you to turn and talk to a partner about why you say so-and-so is a bad character, whatever it is that you're doing, and what's the evidence that support it? That's a different kind of conversation. And you're going around and you're listening and you're looking in to see, are they understanding the concept? Okay? So I want you to start thinking in those manners. And yes, one of our expectations is every 5 to 10 minutes, be quiet. Which means give them a question and let them answer it and struggle with it. And see if they can do it. In math, you're just doing you could do a problem and then do one by yourself. Let me see if you got it, right?
Okay. All right, I will let you because you've got less than 45 minutes. We're going to do another brain brief really quick. I think you'll like it. And then we're going to go into content specific, and we'll give you more instructions as we get closer. So I need everyone to stand. You don't need anything in your hands. Simple, mm-hmm. Right? Okay? Ready? Walk.
stop. When I say stop, you walk. Stop. You walk. Oh. Hold on, it's opposite. Walk. Stop. Walk. Now, phase two. When I say name, you're going to say your name. When I say clap, you clap once. You're going to do this with stop and walk, so backwards. Okay?
Uh-huh.
So, stop. Name?
Patrice.
No, but
walk. Stop. Clap. Walk. Name? Okay. So everything goes backwards, okay? Right? So now you're about to clap and your clap and your name are backwards. So stop is walk, walk is stop, name is clap, clap is name. Okay? Ready? Walk. Stop. Name. Clap.
Great.
Stop.
Oh my gosh.
Walk. Okay. Third phrase. Pose. Okay? Like you're, you know, like Vogue, like pose. Okay? Or dance. Whatever your dance is. Okay? Pose or dance. So walk is stop, stop is walk. Clap is name, name is clap. Pose is pose, dance is dance.
Okay.
Ready, stop. Clap.
Okay.
Name. Walk. Pose. Very good. Dance. Stop. Literally stop. No. Okay.
Oh.
Okay, walk. Name. Pose. Okay, now your pose and now your dance are going to flip. So everything's backwards. Okay, this is the last one. Ready? Stop. Dance. Walk. Oh. Name. Clap.
And
stop back to your seat.